Hi folks, welcome back. So I just finished this book, Co-Intelligence by Ethan Mollick, and I wanted to review it. I've been reading Mollick's Substack newsletter, it's called One Useful Thing, for quite a while, and he's one of the preeminent writers today that's talking about how to concretely use AI in day-to-day knowledge work. He published a paper about it where he looked at how consultants use it and what impact it has on their work. I've actually covered that paper on the channel. I'll leave a link below. And he mentions that work in this book. So if you've read his newsletter, this book is kind of like a much lengthier exposition of the same themes. Now, there's the table of contents. And part one is mostly a very high-level layperson's background of how LLMs work, how they're trained, what to expect from them. And then part two is where all the meat of this book is, how you can actually use AI as a creative, as a coworker, as a tutor, as a coach, and so on. And that's mostly the part I want to talk about in my review. You can see that to start with, I had a great time reading this book simply because you can see how much I've marked it up. So it is overall a really great book. I have some minor critiques and some missed opportunities, I feel like, for the book, but we'll get to that. So overall, it's a great book. I think it does a great job of explaining for the unfamiliar layperson all the various ways they could use LLMs and AI in their day-to-day work. And he explains this, like I just showed you in the table of contents, through the lens of what kind of roles LLMs could play in your daily work. You could use it as a tutor, as a coach, as a coworker, and he goes into great depth for how each of these roles can be used. He talks about prompting and how to construct prompts, though this is not a book about prompt engineering. He covers that only at a pretty high level. In the chapter on AI as a person, he actually has a pretty large section of that chapter about that famous New York Times article by Kevin Roose, where he was chatting with ChatGPT and it was stalking him and trying to convince him to do all sorts of weird stuff. And so the author here, Ethan Mollick, has a pretty long chat with ChatGPT about that article. And that whole section is pretty interesting. There's some pieces where ChatGPT defends what it was doing and pretends like its feelings were hurt. So anyway, that's an amusing aside. But also in that chapter, he does talk about how people are beginning to form relationships with these AIs simply because they're so good at language. I remember seeing this tweet where a startup that was doing online therapy used LLMs instead of real therapists, and the patient's satisfaction actually went up, but only when they were in the dark about it. When it was revealed that there was an LLM on the other side, their satisfaction tanked. He talks about replica, where people can build these personas or replicate the voice and personality of people they already know, of famous people, and so on. In the chapter on creativity, he points out how the top LLMs today are already beating humans when it comes to just raw idea generation and brainstorming. So that's the top of the funnel when it comes to creativity. He talks about how all the image generation models are giving so many more people a channel to express their artistic vision and reducing the barrier to do that. So even people that feel like they don't have a lot of artistic talent now have a way to come up with an artistic vision and give it some real form. My two favorite chapters were the one that talks about AI as a coworker and the one that talks about AI as a tutor, and to a lesser extent, the one about AI as a coach, which is a bit similar. In my mind, at least, the heart of this book is the chapter that talks about AI as a coworker. And yeah, he builds on a lot of the work he did for his BCG paper that I was talking about before. One of the main ideas of that chapter is that he views a job as a bundle of tasks. And then he says that, yes, the AI can handle many of those tasks, and it will probably be able to handle a lot more in the future. But a job is so much more than just a bundle of those tasks. And he talks about the types of tasks that you'd want to keep for yourself, for humans, the types of tasks you'd want to delegate, but still check, and then the types of tasks that could be fully automated. You don't even need to check what the AI did. He has a bunch of metaphors around it, things like cyborgs and centaurs. Centaurs are people that use AI in very specific ways, so there's a clear delineation between the tasks that the humans perform and the ones that the AIs perform, whereas cyborgs just use AIs so fluidly that there's no clear line in how a given task gets performed. They just weave it into the way they solve that task. The chapter on AI as a tutor was really interesting. I've seen this with my own children who are in elementary school. It's so easy to quickly whip up a prompt that will give them a quiz, that will grade their answers, that will patiently and helpfully give them hints if they get something's wrong. It will give them feedback on how they did. So this whole idea of using an LLM as a one-on-one personal coach or personal tutor that tailors its feedback and level of difficulty to the individual student, that idea I think is really important and something that's totally going to change the way we do education. All right, so overall, I thought it was a great read. It's a very timely read. People who are wondering how AI can actually concretely be used for day-to-day knowledge work should really read this book. Now, onto a few critiques, or what I like to think of more as missed opportunities for linking to some very rich existing bodies of work that could have really added a lot of depth and color in the right places. So let's start with the chapter on people, where he talks about how people relate to these AIs with really deep conversations and things like that. Now, Sherry Turkle has done a lot of work in this area. She's published quite a few books talking about this whole dynamic. The last one I read was a book titled Alone Together, but she's written many other books. And she talks a lot about how people of all ages relate to robots and machines. And this was all pre-LLMs, of course. This was from the early 2000s. But there's a lot of work here that looks at how people relate to machines and robots. And I think we can learn from that body of work. Now, coming to the chapter on AI as a coworker, to his credit, Malik does talk about depending on the AI too much and how in many of the studies that he did, that some other authors did, that he cites, often people will use the output of the AI without even editing it, and how this might lead to depending on the AI too much and getting complacent. And here I feel the entire body of work that has looked at automation and human factors, going all the way back to the 60s, 70s, that entire body of work has a lot to say about this topic of automation dependency. Nicholas Carr wrote the book The Shallows about basically this problem about automation dependency. Going back even earlier, Bainbridge wrote about the ironies of automation. That's a paper I've covered on this channel. I'll leave a link below. So there's a lot of work that talks about systems like autopilot in planes or automating machinery in industrial settings, and tries to understand how humans deal with automation and how humans perform or how they adapt to a role where they become monitors of the machine rather than doing the task itself and the kinds of pitfalls that mode has. So I felt like that was a missed opportunity. There's a huge body of work that talks about how humans deal with machines taking over parts of their job. One more thing I noticed was that I feel like Malik is trying too hard in this book to build a case for why AI won't simply replace jobs. He's trying to build a case that they will be helpers, they will augment humans, they will complement humans, but they won't necessarily replace entire jobs. And this goes back to his framing of a job being a bundle of tasks. And even if AI can do some of these tasks, there's still a lot of elements of the job that will fall to the human. And I think that might be true now, but it might not be true for very long. There's also plenty of jobs that are actually just tasks. Things like being a customer service rep or writing a lot of marketing copy or things like that. So I wasn't too convinced by his case for why AI will only augment and not replace. There's also the case that Venkatesh Rao makes on his blog over at Ribbon Farm, where he says that AI doesn't have to be the very tippy top of human cognitive performance. It just needs to replace the median, or as he calls it, mediocre knowledge worker. And that isn't that hard. In this book, Malik talks a lot about how AI can't do things like critical thinking or creativity, but the median knowledge worker isn't doing a lot of those things either. So I feel like he's romanticizing these human traits a little bit and not being hard-nosed enough or realistic enough about the full impact of this. In one place, he does admit that LLMs will make us realize that a lot of jobs are boring and not meaningful. And I couldn't help but remember David Graeber's book about bullshit jobs when he said that. So overall, I feel like this is a great book. It's a very timely book. But when I was reading it, I couldn't help but make these links to some prior work, some large existing bodies of work, which if Malik had maybe gone into in a bit more detail, it would have really enriched the book. But great book, nonetheless, would recommend. I hope you enjoyed that. And if you like content like this, please consider subscribing, like the video, and I will see you next time. Thank you very much.